Welcome to this episode of Best of America by Horseback. I'm Tom Seay. As we're blessed to travel all over America to trail rides and festivities and events and meet wonderful people, the question they ask the most is about our trail ride that we took from the Atlantic to the Pacific. It was a 3,000-mile ride over 4.5 months through 81 cities and towns. It was continuous every step of the way, including riding alone across the deserts of Southern California to make it every step of the way. It captured the dreams of many people around the country. I had no idea anyone else would really want to go. 257 people, to be exact. President Jimmy Carter visited with us. President Ronald Reagan sent a phone call of congratulations as we did the ride. I want you to sit back and enjoy this show, an overview of the Atlantic to the Pacific ride. Maybe your dream can come true as well, to ride in a very special place with very special people. Sit back and relax. I'll be right back.
Part of this show is brought to you by Mill Creek Manufacturing, makers of the first compact and stainless steel manure spreaders. They also make spin groomer arena rakes and now a new line of outdoor power equipment like the Mighty Ox log splitters and wood chippers. All top quality, high value equipment, all made in the USA. And by Spurs Big Fix, wound, skin, and hoof treatment. The more you use it, the more you'll love it.
We know who made that hitch. We know who cut the steel, who milled the ball, and who welded the seams. We know who tested, measured, and checked. We even know who thought the whole thing up. We're B&W, and we know your hitch. Because we don't make them halfway around the world. We make them all right here. B&W. Trusted.
In 1995, Tom Seay organized and led the American Transcontinental Trail Ride from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific, 3,000 miles through 81 cities and towns, every step of the way by horseback. To our knowledge, this was the only successful organized trail ride from ocean to ocean. On this episode, Tom shares with us an overview of that monumental ride.
The ride actually started when I was about 5 years old, some years ago. I would ride my little pony around Central Virginia and I'd look at the Blue Ridge Mountains just west of us. I'd think someday I would take my pony and I'd ride all the way to those mountains, or maybe beyond. That dream stuck with me over the years. As I became older and later in life, there was an opportunity for me to take some time and do that ride, so I did. I had no idea 257 people would want to join us. I had no idea that President Jimmy Carter would visit with us, President Ronald Reagan would give us a phone call, CNN would visit with us and spend some time with us, and that we would be featured in a European documentary on the American West.
The trip began at the ocean on Tybee Island, just east of Savannah, Georgia. Tom asked a local priest to attend the kickoff and bless the ride. It was the beginning of a journey that would change the lives of everyone who went.
I borrowed a horse trailer, rode across the state of Georgia, had a real good time, came home, and every morning when I got up, I thought, I wonder what they're doing today. I wonder what they're doing today. I called them 3 or 4 times. And Tom said, why don't you come back? I said, I believe I will. I took my daughter. I think she was 18 or 19. And I met Tommy in the ride on the east side of Dallas. And we joined up there. It's something I'll never forget. And I've had a wonderful time.
A French film producer was in the United States producing a documentary on the American West. He heard about our ride and sought us out. And we were in the desert of New Mexico. The day he met us, my son John was leading the trail ride.
Where are you coming from?
Savannah, Georgia.
Oh.
All the way?
Mm-hmm.
Since January 2nd.
My family came here in 1711, and my original ancestors were surveyors of American trails, colonial trails, and so yeah, I'd like to think there's a little bit of that in me to explore and to lead people on. And there's so many dimensions to the American, to America and to the West, but a trail master, and to take them, it's really an honor.
As the ride got closer to the date, I was concerned about a couple of things. One, the safety and welfare of all the riders and horses all the way across America. So I pre-drove the route to find every source of water, every camping site, every facility that we may need, so that we were prepared for anything.
We went through 83 cities and towns. He was so organized that he compiled a notebook in every single town of every business that he thought his riders may need, from veterinarians, farriers, feed stores, down to laundromats or grocery stores, even tire stores or repair shops, with names, addresses, and phone numbers of all these businesses in every single town.
There's nothing common about any of these people except for their inner desire to do something they always wanted to do. Something.
Yeah, just in a different country and talking to people. You find a lot of different people out, I guess, you know. Sometimes you'll even find cameramen riding horses. You know, you never know, you know.
It makes no difference if you finish the trip. The trick is that you start the trip. That's the trick.
One gentleman from Florida, Mr. Barco, was severely ill with heart failure. But his lifetime dream was to ride across America. He too wanted to have that dream and make it come true. But the reality was, it probably wasn't going to be possible. But he begged to go, and with the blessings of his wife and family, knowing that he may not end the trip, we agreed to take him on that trip and take him to California.
When I started this, and the doctor learned that I was doing on horseback, they advised me to stay off of horses. And my answer to them was that I would not stay off of horses. If I'm going to die, it's not going to be sitting in a rocking chair waiting. I'm going to be on a horse's back.
He actually gained strength on the trip, was much stronger, and 3 years later, he was still riding. It was a great dream come true.
Ghost town. It is a ghost town. I imagine we'll have to post a guard tonight to keep them being spooked.
Old cowpoke went riding up one dark and windy day. Pioneer Ridge he rested as he went along his way. Is that it?
People have pioneered this country and covered wagons by horseback, and we have a lot of respect for them. They had an awful lot of grit and fortitude to go through the conditions and things that they went through and keep going all the way to California, and as far as they went. And we have a lot of modern day conveniences, and it's tough out there some days.
You can look around here and you can tell that, yes, there were people here, and part of that past is still here. And I rode my horse up that over there, it kind of spooked a little bit. And I realized the horse sensed something probably more than I did. It felt something going on in this country.
As I lay in bed at night over the years, thinking how I'd like to ride to where the famous westerns were, or the beautiful mountains out west, or through the plains of this country, I would dream about it, and I'd make notes on my little table. As we got to the point where the ride would begin and we would do the ride, I built a covered wagon, and in that covered wagon, I put my bed that I would dream in, and I took the table that I would write on. So those thoughts would transform from wishful thinking to a reality.
If you are interested in learning more about Best of America by Horseback, visit our website at bestofamericabyhorseback.com. There you can view our show schedule on RFD-TV, learn how to join us for upcoming rides and events, benefits of our trail club and how to join, find riding locations and dude ranches by state, shop the online store for Best of America by Horseback logo gear, read our monthly newsletter to stay up to date, and learn about our sponsors and their quality products. It's all here at bestofamericabyhorseback.com.
Tom Seay is sharing memories of the trail ride he organized and led from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean in 1995. They rode nearly 3,000 miles through 83 cities and towns every step of the way by horseback. It took almost an entire year to plan the logistics of the ride and what to expect from riders taken from their daily routines and comforts of home to 4.5 months in the saddle where conditions changed daily.
It's like a calendar picture.
And you like it?
Oh, I love it. Every day is different.
I was concerned about the morale, attitude, and safety of all of our riders. When you remove people from their safe environment, that safety net of being at home, everything they're familiar with, their daily routine, their newspaper, their television, electricity, all the things that they have as a habit of life is going to be removed. So I asked a professor of psychology to help me plan on what to expect. He said there would be three stages. One, the gathering of the people where they would be as excited as kids at a birthday party. And then it would move into a stage of kids in the back seat of a car or a truck on a long trip. We'd all get a little antsy and a little tired and maybe a little short-tempered. And then the third aspect would be these men and women would bond like men in war, and that bond would never be broken. This will come through the significance of the ride and how these people bonded. You can see it at the end of the ride, how everybody developed that bond. One of the hardest things for me was to lead a group of such diverse people and opinions and backgrounds, and to give them, make sure they had their freedom to do what they wanted to do, but keep them in a safety net, and some days be their best friend, and other days, this is the way it's gonna be.
I admired your ability to check your temper. I was real, real impressed with your ability.
Here's Paul, he's young, he's worked, he's been successful, but there's more to life than just working in the assembly line. I mean, there's more to that. It's more than just going to work, going home, going to work. It's got to be more to life than that.
That's not living.
That's not living. That's existing.
That's right.
That's existing.
On day to day, just exist. And this is life. You're experiencing something different every day.
Yeah, but it's not a real job. So in a sense, we're in pursuit of something that don't exist anymore.
No. It's not what you get out there. It's what changes you inside. Whether they ever go on another trail or ride or not, it doesn't make any difference. You're a better person because you learn to become independent. You don't let society rob you of your independence. You don't let them rob you of your instincts. And that's a secret. And you just never let them slow you down.
I said, any of you want to surrender?
I'll say one thing for you, JD. Oh, you got style.
Personally, I was very humbled that he would compare the spirit of John Wayne and clips of movies of John Wayne to our trail ride. I was personally humbled by it, but moreover, I think it reflected the spirit and attitude of all of our riders that here in America, that spirit still exists today as it did in the Old West, that the American spirit is something to be admired and loved.
When we got to Vicksburg, We had to cross the Mississippi River, and we had permission to go through Vicksburg. We had a police escort, and on the other side, we had a police escort, but the bridge commission controlled the bridge. After weeks and weeks of trying to get permission and get this permit, we were up to the day of crossing the bridge, and we still hadn't gotten the permit. We had a young deputy take us, escort us through Vicksburg, and it was morning, it was during the week, it was traffic time. He said, look, I'm gonna take you guys down on the interstate. We're gonna ride on the shoulder of the interstate, and we're gonna come up on the exit right before the river, and we're gonna get you there a lot faster than going through this traffic. But you gotta promise me, if the state police stops us, that you're gonna back me up, because I'm gonna tell them, I caught you guys down here, and I'm escorting you off of the interstate. He got us to the bridge, and at that time, the Mississippi River Bridge had three lanes on it. And one lane was a railroad track, then two lanes, traffic going and coming. Well, we waited for the train. As soon as the train came across, we only had so many minutes for the next train, so he said, go. And we're like, well, we don't have permission. He said, I've got traffic stopped on this end. I've radioed a fellow deputy on the other side. He's holding traffic on that side. Go, just cross the river. We got you covered. What was amazing is that all the red tape, all the bureaucracy, these two deputies just said, hey, we're not gonna let you miss going every step of the way by not letting you ride across the Mississippi Bridge. It was just a neat memory from that ride.
I'm Steve Tucker. I'm the founder and president of Tucker Trail Saddles. We listen to our customers. We leverage the experience and craftsmanship of our team. And we embrace the goal to produce the most comfortable and functional trail saddle in the world. And we believe that we are offering with the New Horizon the absolute best and most comfortable trail riding saddle available today.
I've ridden thousands of miles all over this country. The saddle I choose is a Tucker saddle.
Hello, I'm Gary Stice. I am the number one dealer for Lakota trailers nationwide. Please stop in and see our new facility. Our new facility has a very large display area where we will have up to a dozen trailers inside the building, a very large service center where we can service all your needs. We can take care of your horses as well as your trailer and show you new trailers also. Please stop in and see us on Interstate 71 south of Columbus, Ohio.
You're watching Best of America by Horseback as Tom Seay reflects on the American Transcontinental Trail Ride, a ride he planned, organized, and led in 1995 from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific, every step of the way by horseback.
The day we arrived at the Pacific Ocean, a small group of us rode through the traffic with a police escort. And when we'd been riding so many days, in some respects, it was just a continuation of the ride until we turned the corner and you could smell the salt water and you could see the ocean. And the reality that we had made it, we were there, came to pass.
I really didn't think a whole lot about that ride until several years afterwards. It has been one of the most important events of my life.
My mother was 66 years old, and she decided she was going to go on this ride with us, and she did. And talking about how this ride changed people's lives and impacted them, my mom is now 87, and she has Alzheimer's. And there are days when she doesn't even know her name. But if you ask her about riding her horse from the Atlantic to the Pacific, her eyes will light up, she'll smile, and she'll tell you that she rode her horse, Percance, a Peruvian paso, from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific. And of course, most people she tells this to, they think that's just the Alzheimer's talking. But she really did do it. She remembers it to this day.
those tears.
How often do you think about the ride?
Oh, at least twice a week. A pet tells me it's 21 years. When I went, it was just a spur-of-the-moment thing. It's something I'll never forget.
On every person around about us, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
Marco, all of us didn't think we were going to make it.
Dreams had come true to arrive in California at the ocean. I had so many mixed emotions. I had great joy that we had safely done it, and so many people had had such a great experience and their dreams had come true. And I was torn between, it's over, what do I do now? Exhilaration. You have all these emotions that come together and you're not sure. And after we arrived and there was the blessing of the ride and the ride was complete and people were mingling and talking to the press and so forth, there was almost a feeling of regret that we had gotten there and now the dream was over. In later years, we found out the dream was just beginning.
Later, in 2005, Tom's American Transcontinental Trail Ride became the inspiration for this television series, going to the Best of America by horseback. His first episode was on the Atlantic Ocean, and 11 years later, he is still taking viewers to some of the most beautiful places in America by horseback.